afterwards, presentation and exhibition, which I hope you had a chance to look at. Really, this part of the event is all about the research, and I'm really, really, really thrilled to introduce you to our partners and researchers, starting with Lee Humber from Ruskin College. We've also got Jess Tilling from My Life, My Choice, and we have Debbie Molino, who's from Liverpool University. And we are so excited to have had the opportunity to work with these very experienced researchers who've all had a different angle to talk to you about. And what they're going to tell you is about some of the important research behind this whole project. And it will give you lots of context behind the narrative of our Hedge Impact Project. So I hope you really enjoy it. And can I welcome Lee to start the presentation?
I'm very pleased to be here in front of you all, and great to see such a great turnout. I'll be as brief as possible. I just wanted to introduce to you a little bit about who I am, very briefly, and then a little bit about the project, but then Jess will go into it in much more detail. So my name is Lee Humber, Dr. Lee Humber. I spent 35 years working with people with learning disabilities of various ages and in various arenas, and more recently I've moved into academia. My area of research was looking at the employment of people with learning disabilities. People here will be aware of one of the things that is thought to signify the fact that somebody has got a learning disability is that they're incapable of working. Well, so I researched that and found that that wasn't the case at all. During my research, I identified a number of people with learning disabilities who'd been employed during World War II. And then I put that to one side, finished my research and moved into academia. So later on, when all of the commemoration of World War I was taking place, a certain amount of funding became available to explore different avenues of World War I. So I went back to my ideas about people with learning disabilities serving during war and started to explore whether I could find people with learning disabilities in World War I. So that's how this research project came about. So I looked for a reputable partner in the community who worked with people with learning disabilities. I couldn't find anybody, so I turned to My Life, My Choice. And so we've been working together for the last 2 years, something like that, 18 months, 2 years, and massively successful. So let me introduce, first of all, sort of, if you like, first phase of our research. Okay, so, unforgotten soldiers of the First World War. So, people will be familiar with lots of these phrases. Your country needs you, it's your duty, come on boys. And that very, very famous poster of General Kitchener pointing out to Britons of all kind. It was imagined, of course, that Britons of all kind didn't include people with learning disabilities. People might be aware that the term for learning disabilities is a relatively modern one. In these times, 1914, there were a range of terms, so idiot, imbecile, and a relatively feeble-minded was just coming into use in 1914, and a very, very new term, mental deficiency, was being used, all of which described what we now would call people with learning disabilities. Now, it has been believed that the Britons that Kitchener is pointing out there didn't include people with learning disabilities, and our research has taken great strides forward, especially over the last few months, in terms of proving that to be completely wrong. Okay, so Great Britain declared war 4th August 1914, and there's the sort of, if you like, founding statement to that terrible disaster that was World War One. Okay, here's the next one. I won't go into great detail about the history of learning disabilities. People might be aware that around about 1870, in fact exactly in 1870, a number of institutions were built. So Debbie will tell you a bit about the Royal Albert Institution up in Lancaster in the north of England. There were other institutions around London. Around this way, there was an institution called St. Lawrence's Hospital. That was built in 1870. To the north of London, there was a hospital called Leavesden Hospital. That was built in 1870, designed by the same architect. In other words, for some reason, they decided, the authorities decided in 1870 that they needed specific institutions for people with something called imbecility or mental deficiency latterly. Okay, so that's when 1870 really is when the modern history of what we today know as learning disabilities really began. Okay, 1870, when people with learning disability. If I had another slide here, I could show you some of the ways that learning disability was diagnosed in those days. Now, there's a massive, big, long list. If you go into, I'm not sure whether it's the case at the Royal Albert, but certainly in Leavesden Hospital, was it in Hertfordshire, there's a big, long list of how people with learning disabilities were diagnosed. And this list includes things like kicked in the head by a horse, or not worked for 10 years, or a whole range of very weird and wonderful diagnoses of learning disabilities, none of which would stand up to any kind of cross-examination today. Okay? So the point about this is it starts in sort of 1870. That's the modern phase of what we call learning disabilities. Okay? So these areas were variously called. Some were called colonies, although colony was often more to do with insanity than it was for people with learning disabilities. These places were massive. I don't know if anybody's ever visited some of these places. You won't visit St. Lawrence because it's been razed to the ground. There are remnants of Leavesden Hospital in Hertfordshire that are still available. And if people are interested in this history, I do recommend that you go to Leavesden. There's a fantastic guy there called Martin Brooks who does a sort of tour of it and explains everything to you. But as this slide makes clear, these places were, if you like, villages unto themselves. They had their own farms, they had their own factories. In fact, around the complex of learning disability institutions, there was almost sort of an internal market. So learning institutions would trade with each other. So Leavesden might be really good at making shoes, for example. So they'd sell shoes to St. Lawrence's, which would in return send milk back to. So it was kind of almost an internalised system. It was, if you like, to use the modern parlance, it was inclusive exclusion. People were excluded because they were incarcerated in these things, but then that system of exclusion was inclusive. It traded with each other. There were these internal markets. Okay, next one. I've made this point already. People were called imbeciles, mentally deficient. Lunatics was more to do really with people who were insane. That's Littlemore, which people might know in Oxfordshire. That's still in existence, massively modernised, based on that same area of land. Those buildings that you see there, which is from an old photograph, are still in use today. And people find that often areas like this, even though they've been sort of repurposed, retain that old sort of purpose, if you like. So, for example, if you find, if you see a street, Union Street, look for some kind of Victorian building. You might be looking to find an old workhouse. But in Oxford, where I come from, there's an old workhouse, and the bits of the workhouse that corresponded to the old bit. So if there was a workhouse that was part of the workhouse that was a hospital bit, that retains its purpose today. So there was some kind of care service there even now. In Oxford, the old workhouse has got mental health services on the site where the old workhouse is, a hospital, a learning disability aspect. So they retain their own purposes, which is generally interesting but not specific relevant to the presentation. So we'll move on. Okay, war hospitals. Lots of the lunatic asylums, as it says there, and lots of the mental deficiency institutions, like for example Leavesden in North London, were repurposed for as war hospitals. Now, that's interesting in all sorts of ways, because obviously if soldiers are coming back and occupying these beds, then the people who used to occupy them, that is some people with mental deficiency or people with learning disabilities, obviously they've been shipped out. So that raises the question, where did they go? Where did they go? And so our research started to investigate where where these people disappeared to. Did they take up war work, for example? If they took up war work, well, one of the reasons they were put in the institution in the first place was because of the fallacy that people with learning disabilities don't work, can't work. Well, clearly, if they were working during the World War I, they can work. So why were they in the institution in the first place? So that was one aspect of the research. Where did these people go? Did they do war work at home? The other aspect of the work, which we've made great strides on in the last month or so, is did they go and serve at the front? And if they served at the front, where did they serve? If they served at the front, did they fight? Or did they have a different job? So that's what we've been looking at. Well, lots of this I've covered already, but the kind of, if you like, look at the aspects of that, if you like, that underneath it all, why are we researching this? Underneath it all is we're researching this, and we started to research this and continue to, and this really keys in, I think, with what Magpie Dance tries to do, and why this collaboration between us and Magpie Dance is so important to us and on a general level. What this research has always tried to do is to say, is to challenge the myth that people with learning disabilities don't contribute anything to society. We want to challenge that myth. We want to show, by showing that people with learning disabilities, as Debbie's research, she's got a beautiful phrase that I won't pinch because that I'll steal a thunder. She's got a beautiful phrase later on about what people with learning disabilities add. If we thought, if we could show that people with learning disabilities were part and parcel of this terrible war effort, that people with learning disabilities joined up, went overseas, fought and died alongside people who were non-learning disabled, well then that shows once again that they're not separate. People with learning disabilities aren't separate. They're every bit as much as society and contribute every bit as much as anybody else given half a chance. So that's the underlying reason for why we started the research and continue to do so. The other kind of reason is because all of us involved are really nosy. You know, we want to find out. If we're told, no, that doesn't exist, we want to know, well, are we sure that it doesn't exist? Can we prove that actually it doesn't exist? Okay, so, and this is what the rest of this first part of this presentation does. The next bit, which Jess is going to introduce now, I might chip in, it really details the first phase of this research. What did our four or five researchers from My Life, My Choice, where did they go, how did they research, what did they discover, what more is there to discover? So I'll shut up and let Jess have a comment.
Thank you, Mark.
Yep.
My name's Jess, and I am from an organisation called My Life, My Choice in Oxfordshire. And we are a learning disability self-advocacy organisation. I've been there for around 3 years, but the charity has been going for about 20 years now. And I'm joined today by my colleague, Sarah, who's come to help me deliver the presentation. Now, unfortunately, we would have been here today with our co-researchers, Tommy and Tyrone, but unfortunately last night we were told last minute that they weren't able to make it for whatever reason. So we wish them well, but you'll see some pictures of them in here as well, and a couple of me and Lee, I think, snuck in too.
Yeah, unfortunately.
So Lee...
Move on, shall I?
So Lee came to My Life, My Choice about 2 years ago, as we said, and that's when we started to think about how could we work together to research into what people with learning disabilities did and contributed during the First World War. And for all of us, it's a really, really interesting topic. Tommy, whose glasses you can see in the front, his brother is actually in the services. So for him, it was a really, really interesting thing to learn about, and for the rest of us as well. So we met Lee for the first time at Ruskin College, which is also in Oxford. And you showed us a film, actually, didn't you?
Yeah.
And we learned about the Battle of the Somme and talked a lot about the Great War. And it was during this time when we met you, if you can just get one to the next slide, please, that we started to learn about where people lived, where people with learning disabilities would have lived 100 years ago, what sorts of activities they would have done, what sorts of things they would have been up to, but also
ages of people who went to war. Now, the guys that we were working with, Tommy, Tyrone and Shane, our co-researchers, they're all in their early 20s. So we started off from the very beginning saying, you guys probably would have been at the right age to go to war during the First World War at some point. We also talked about the fact that potentially they might have lived in the Cowley Workhouse, which is really close to actually where one of them lived. And we talked about the conditions in there. And one thing that stands out is the bed situation that people had and how people were treated. So the bed situation was, the bed was always warm because one person would be in the bed, they'd go off to do their shift, the next person would be in the bed. And we talked about the three of them who'd been friends for their whole lives sharing that same bed. And we couldn't quite get our heads around why that was significant and why people were treated in such a way and why you weren't allowed your own bed. So it's very different to how it is now. So we also talked a lot about poverty, the lifestyle that people would have led, and the difference between the rich and the poor. So people often went to war during the First and Second World War because it was the promise of a better life. It was the promise that they would get 5p per day, which in the time was a lot of money, but they would get somewhere of their own to sleep, somewhere warm and dry, and that they would get fed. And for lots of people, that was a real incentive to go. And they were also told that it was going to be an adventure. So a lot of people would sign up, even from a very young age. You had to be over the age of 16, 17?
16.
But people as young as 12 were signing up because they thought it was the thing that they had to do. And they would go home, if they could, to their families or to whoever was around them to say, I've signed up, and that was it. Sometimes that was the last thing for them. When we met Lee, he had loads and loads of posters and maps and everything around for us to see. So he used all of the resources that he had before and really helped to explain and embed this story into our own minds of where we needed to start. So you can see a picture of us up in the corner of looking at some of the posters and some of the advertisements that would have gone out at the time. And then we looked at some of the newspapers and the printed documents during the First World War. And that was where we really began. And so we then started to research in our own time as well, but Lee really amazingly got us into the Cowley archive, just the local archive that we had. And we got to use a lot of researching skills and some primary investigative skills where we learned a lot about people with learning disabilities that wouldn't be recognised at the time as having a learning disability. As Lee said, they have lots of other names. But we actually, interestingly, got to look through lots of records, and we looked through lots of records of people who had come back from the war, and we looked at lots of censuses that said of people who maybe before the war were in the workhouse, and after the war were nowhere to be found. And so we thought that was a really good starting place of where to find some people. So it's a really in-depth conversation, and some really good research went on. But it was a really, really good experience of us to be able to look at the historical records that we have and almost take a step back in time to see what it would have been like for those people. But we couldn't quite track some of them down. But we do have some names that we can share with you at the end.
Don't tell them that.
So moving on from just looking at the archives, we thought, right, we're going to go to some people who know a little bit more about this than we do. So we went to a place called the Soldiers of Oxfordshire Museum. It was a brilliant museum, and they even have a trench set up that you can walk through and you can have a look at, which is brilliant. Whilst we were there, we had a really brilliant opportunity to look through some of the historical artifacts that they have. So they made up a rations pack, which showed you the types of food that people would have eaten, and the stale bread that you got sent away with, which only got more stale as you carried on. We also looked at all of the weights of everything that they had to carry. So they had big packs, and they would have their helmets, and then they'd have rifles, and one pair of socks. And we got to carry them and try them on, and it was just incredible to know how heavy everything was, because you had to carry everything with you, and then as soon as you'd set up your camp, when you're moving on, you have to pack everything up and carry it with you again. And it was a really tiresome job. We travel to has worked with people with learning disabilities, and she lived in a place called Grenadine, which is just in North Belgium, and she hosted us, and it was really, really brilliant, and we got to learn so much and go to so many different places. And if you just skip to the next slide, please. Thank you. So we travelled by Eurostar, and we all decided that we probably lived in luxury in comparison to many, many soldiers who had made the same or a similar journey to us. So we, Flo has also this lady, lovely lady in the picture. So that's Tommy and Tyrone, and we decided from the very beginning that we were going to keep kind of a record or a mental note of what it felt like and what we saw and how we think other people would have felt if they were travelling on a similar journey to us but 100 years ago. For some of us, it was the first time that we'd ever been to Europe, and definitely for some of us, the first time we'd ever been on the Eurostar. So we were, although we were having a luxurious trip in comparison, we were still going on a journey ourselves, and we were still thinking about being away from home and maybe some of the fears that we would have shared. So in Belgium, we were very, very cold and very, very tired when we got there, and we thought that's probably fitting. A lot of people would have felt cold and tired when we got there. We went in January, so it was very cold. And then when we got there, we got to work straight away because we were only there for a short amount of time. But Flo had very kindly put together a kind of pack for us to work through, where we went to lots of different war graves, which we'll show you, and even to the Menin Gate as well, which was a brilliant experience. So Grenadine isn't that far from Ypres, or Ypres, if you prefer. So we went to the local cemetery, which is just in the, so Ypres has a wall around it, and it's in within the wall of the city. So we went there, and we started to look at the graves. Now, not something that we noticed was that there are so many graves in such small places. But also, the graves have many different stories to tell about them and about the soldiers. So if you've probably all seen a war grave at some point, but they're usually white, or mostly white, and then they have different religious symbols on them. If the symbol or the religious symbol of the soldier was known, they sometimes have a name, they sometimes have an inscription, and then they sometimes have dates as well. So it was really interesting to see where different people had come from, what regions they had been in, and it really helped us on our search for the people we were looking for. So something that we found really interesting and very upsetting was the story of the unknown soldiers. And now this is a very common story, as we found out, the more we were there, the more that we found. But these are people who, their names were unknown, their identities were unknown, and they still remain unknown. So they are the soldiers of the Great War, unknown to God. So we also went to Tynecott Cemetery, where 12,000 soldiers from the British Empire now rest peacefully. And this is one of the largest cemeteries that we went to, and it's in a really vast open expanse. Now, we spent a lot of time driving around Belgium, and if anybody's been to Belgium, you know it's pretty flat. And one thing that we found really interesting, which we learned actually from the Soldiers of Oxford Museum, was that camouflage was first introduced in the First World War, or the khaki colour people wore. Before that, it was bright colours. And we really started to understand why people wore such plain, neutral tones, earthy colours, if you like, because there was nowhere for them to hide. They just had to blend into their surroundings. And this is just another picture of us walking around Tynecott to show you how fast it is. So, in Belgium, there's a place called the Menin Gate. We've seen that throughout time when we commemorate any war history. But at the Menin Gate, every night at 8 p.m, people come to Ypres and they come into the city centre and they close off the road, which you can drive through the gate. They close it off, and every single night they pay their respects and homage to those who lost their lives during any war, but specifically the First and Second War. So the stone walls, you can see the arches, it's quite long, but on every single piece of stone inside there is a name. There's 54,000 soldiers' names who never got to go home, whose names are inscribed on there. And what they also do is they play the bugle, and they also allow you to go up, if you're lucky, and lay flowers for a wreath, and we got to lay a wreath of poppies when we were there. So something that they do really well in Belgium is they keep records of everything. Now, they have a very rich, rich history of the First World War. Unfortunately, a lot of violence took place in and around Belgium. But we went to a local museum, which was in a farmhouse in Tinkeri, which is in Grenadine in northern Belgium. And we actually had one of their local men show us around, and they had so many different things in there, from people's war medals and war memorabilia that they found, to big tanks and guns and things that had just been left alongside of the road as soon as the war was over. They'd all been kept and collated and brought back to this farmhouse where they put everything up for display for people to see. And these are just a couple of pictures of us looking at different things. So we also went to a place called the Hodge Crater in Ypres. Now this crater was really significant because it was actually people from the Pioneer Corps, which was sort of the areas that we were looking at, from Wales, who went over during the First World War, and they dug all the way from no man's land underneath this World War I German information centre, and they blew it up, and then they just went home and lived their lives again, and their story was never told. And if you don't know about the Hodge Crater, you wouldn't know that story. And we thought that's really significant, that these people within the Pioneer Corps, you know, they were just the diggers, really. They did such a big thing, and it was a really important kind of step forward during the First World War. And it's just on the side of this main road, and it's kind of set back, and nobody really, you just drive past it if you wouldn't know what it was. But it was so important, and yet nobody really remembers it. Opposite the crater, on the other side of the road, there's a cemetery. Now, it's very small, but very, very well organised and tucked in. And there's over 3,000 people buried here. And we spent quite some time thinking and reflecting on what we see on the other side of the road and the violence and kind of the step forward in the war. And then all of those who had sadly been affected and lost their lives because of it.
There's a couple more slides on war graves. Shall we skip forward because we're running?
Yeah, no, that's fine. So like I said, we did manage to go to quite a few different places during the war.
Let's do the Linda from Dingwall.
Okay. So wrapping up our time in Belgium, we actually got to the In Flanders Field Museum, which is in the centre of Belgium, and that's amazing. That building was entirely flattened. Actually, Ypres was entirely flattened during the First World War, and they built it back in its likeness. So it was amazing to see that. And then one of the things that they had were actually some of the wooden crosses where people were buried from 1914. They had some of those pristine in good condition in the museum, which we got to see. But when we came back, we were really kind of hot on the trail of finding people. So we found some people in Belgium who were from Oxfordshire, which is what we were looking for. We were trying to find some of the names. But we were also put into contact with a lady called Linda Newbury. Now, Linda Newbury came to visit us in 2016, it seems. So quite a long time ago, it seems like we've known it for ages. And she's written a lot of books, actually, a lot of books that are aimed at a younger audience, for teens and children. But she's done a lot of historical things, and she's done a lot on World War I and World War II. And she came to talk to us and read us through a book called Tilly's Tales. Now, Tilly's Tales was a really interesting story, and it told us about people with disabilities, maybe not being recognised as having a disability, but going to war, but being protected. So in the book, Tilly's Tales, it's from her sister's, from Tilly's account, but it's about her brother and her fiancé, and her brother is so determined that he has to do his part. And everyone says, no, you can't go off to war, it's not for you, let the men do it, you stay home with the women. And he's absolutely determined that he goes, and he does go, and unfortunately, he never returns.
And her interest in this came from her reading of a Siegfried Sassoon poem, in which there's a line that, where Sassoon talked about a simple soldier boy, and that got her thinking in terms of simple, it got her thinking in terms of mental efficiency and learning disabilities. So that's why
Magpie, took us around the museum and he told us about the First World War. And he actually gave us a really good overview of the history of the First World War and then what life would have been like in the trenches. Now they've got these giant floor-to-ceiling pictures in the basement of the Imperial War Museum, which tells you about the history of the First World War. You can see from some of these pictures about how muddy and waterlogged it was. And then they have a trench that you can walk through as well, which is really impressive. So we spent quite a lot of time with Tim, and we spent quite a lot of time looking at the different medical checks that you would have had to have gone through in the process of signing up for the First World War. So it says, could you have passed this health check in your country needs you? So there was so much emphasis from the government and from the Crown, really, that you must do your bit, you must go to war. But then, at the same time, it was, are you good enough to go to war? So you had to be a certain height, a certain weight, you had to have certain eyesight. And it was quite difficult for people to get in, and lots of people who were too short weren't allowed to go, or too young weren't allowed to go, or too old. But after the Battle of the Somme, that kind of changed, and it was more about if you could hold a rifle, you were good to go. Because we lost so many people during that battle that there wasn't an army left to fight the war. So these are the three researchers that we've been working with who would have been here today. So you've got, in order from left to right, you've got Tommy, Tyrone in the middle, and Shane on the end. And these guys have worked so hard on this project, and hopefully we'll continue working on it as well. So these we forget, the unforgotten, the forgotten, and the never found. And these are some of the names that we came up with of people that we're still looking into because we still don't know what happened.
And that's where the sort of first phase of the research ended, really. And so what we've got is lots and lots of leaps into people with learning disabilities who served in the war. We got kind of tantalisingly just beyond us. We've not been able to identify specific names until this last month. And so we want to finish this presentation, really, first of all, with Debbie, will give a short presentation on what she's found researching in the Royal Albert Institute in the North of England, and then I'll finish with a really brief kind of summation about what we've found in Oxford. Well, there's a little gap. Any questions on anything so far? Or anything to contribute? I can take down your notes and write it in a paper.
Why have you got a northern accent if you come from Oxfordshire?
Ah, that's the. Is it a northern accent though? Is it?
It sounds like mine.
East Midlands. Well, yeah, because I was, that's where I was brought up, Leicester, then I went and lived in London for a bit, and then ended up for some reason in Oxfordshire.
I'm glad I missed it. There's a very sad story which I saw recently. I can't remember the exact details about the song Pack Up with the Troubles and Don't Get Back.
Yeah.
It was actually by a musical partnership. It was a song, and then there was a competition, I think it was associated with the military, around or before the First World War, about a song.
Yeah.
It was not really intended to be a military song. In fact, I think the lyricist was a pacifist,
yeah,
and he became utterly horrified that it was used in the First World War.
Yeah.
And he made a lot of money from it, actually, and it was used even more frequently in the Second World War.
Mm.
He retired to peacehaven and eventually killed himself because of the shame of associating the song with military endeavor.
Yeah.
Really sad.
And not the last instance of it, I noticed it. People like Bruce Springsteen have told Donald Trump to stop using it.
Sorry. life histories of people with learning disabilities in the late 19th and 20th, early 20th centuries. My work focuses upon individuals who were admitted into the Royal Albert between 1870 and 1920. The Royal Albert was just one of five specialist charitable institutions which were established for educating children with learning disabilities within this period. Although previous work has been undertook on similar institutions, it focuses on how people with learning disabilities were excluded from society within this period, especially following the 1913 Mental Deficiency Act. Therefore, my research aims to show that individuals were successful in overcoming the constraints put on them by society. And although I've only been researching for 3 months so far, I've uncovered several individual stories which highlight the hidden contributions made by individuals with learning disabilities during World War I. They're not fit enough to live, but fit enough to die is a reference to like the eugenics movement, which sought to eliminate and constrain people with learning disabilities within similar institutions. But then they were fit enough to go and join World War I and come back. So so this is a picture of the Royal Albert. I've already been through this slide, so it's fine. And then this is information about one of the first individuals that I found. So all the men that I'm going to speak about were held in the Royal Albert from childhood mainly. So Albert Edward Davis was born in Stockport on the 5th of November 1881 and was admitted into the Royal Albert Asylum aged 8. He was described as suffering from flat feet that were prone to swelling in warm weather and he could not stand for long. Although the patient's time within the asylum are still under investigation for Terry regiments mainly. So he was posted in France in 1916 where he spent 2 years before going home for just 15 days and then returning to France after the war finished to clean up and other duties. During his time in service, Albert was reprimanded several times for cleanliness, and spent a lot of time in hospital throughout his time in the army. But these were things, variety of illnesses, including scabies, which was probably contracted during his time in the trenches. After the war in 1919, this is Albert's own letter that he wrote, and he's asking the War Office for his medals. Saying that he'd spent time overseas and he thinks he's entitled to them. He did actually get his medals, his medal record. And then this is Charles Henry Wright. There is little information regarding Charles, but I believe the availability of his picture was why I put him into the presentation. He was admitted to the Royal Albert a little bit older at the age of 14. After spending time in what was then known as special schools in Liverpool. Throughout his time in the asylum, he was in good health and went to school and made shoes part-time. Described as making good progress and made much improvement upon his discharge on August 7th, 1913, age 19. We're unsure where Charles went during the war, but he joined the King's Liverpool Regiment and served abroad. Following his discharge from the army, there was further notes made in his casebook, which a priest had requested information on him in regards to his proposed marriage. At the time, eugenics were attempting to put laws into place which restricted the rights of people with learning disabilities to marry and have children. So even though he had served in the war, and no laws being ratified, was still being surveilled, still being watched, and he eugenics discourse was continuing to question his place in society.
Can I just add about the high grading circle? People familiar with the separation between high. There was a line there that said he was called a high grade imbecile. There were sort of two grades that people were sort of generally graded when they went into long stay institutions. It could be regarded as a high grade imbecile or the other side, low grade imbecile. Low grade imbeciles are typically those people who needed lots and lots of care. So they might be non-verbal communicators, etc. They might have physical disabilities as well. High grade imbeciles got the job of looking after them. So there were various government reports over this time that recommended that long stay institutions of this nature should make sure they take on lots of high grade imbeciles, because that meant that people were looking after themselves, which again undermines the whole kind of idea and concept that people learn disabilities having no abilities. It's nonsense.
So the next one is Frank Duck, and Frank Duck was also born in Liverpool. Was admitted into the institution on the 19th of July, age 17. He was discharged in 1915 at the age of 23, enlisted also in the King's Liverpool Regiment. There are no military records available, probably due to the fires which destroyed a number of them. However, he reappears in 1923 when he returns to the asylum. He worked on the asylum and lived with one of the attendants when he was employed there. There were notes made in his casebook after, so like 10 years after his discharge, when he was working there, had already fought in World War I, and he was still being treated as a patient in the asylum rather than somebody that had contributed. In 1931, after almost 10 years, he moved out of his lodgings, which he lived with the attendant, and left the farm against repeated advice according to the casebook, indicating that he didn't enjoy his work there as much. But unfortunately, despite his efforts in 1935, it was reported that he was unemployed and was writing frequent letters back to the asylum to ask for work.
And that's not an uncommon tale of people with
disabilities.
If they were to leave an asylum or a hospital at any point, lots of people went back because life seemed to be better, even though it wasn't a very good quality of life, in the asylum rather than outside the care.
I've got a lot of patients that are researching that go back to the asylum and work. And then this is our last one that I'm going to discuss today. And Joseph was born in Beetle, Cumberland, on March 29, 1893. He was one of the youngest to be admitted into the Royal Albert, arriving at the age of 7 in 1900. Joseph had previously been in the imbecile ward of Beetle Workhouse, where he was admitted alongside his mother in infancy due to his illegitimacy. On his admittance, he was described as a white-haired lad with blue eyes and red lips due to eczema, and was considered to be mischievous, spiteful, and not very obedient. Soon after he was admitted, he was said to be useful, a good messenger, and as a result was placed in the tailoring workshop where he began to learn the trade at the age of 14. Altogether, he spent significantly longer than 7 years than most patients spent in the asylum. However, this wasn't unusual for those supported by the poor law, because the workhouse was reluctant to receive those back that it considered to be mentally deficient. He was eventually discharged aged 22 on August 9th, 1915, and he returned to his mother, who was married in his absence. However, he didn't remain at home long, enlisting shortly afterwards in the King's Own Royal Lancashire Regiment, the 7th Battalion, on the 28th of September 1915, after only being at home for 1 month. It is impossible to say why he decided to leave home so early after returning, as conscription hadn't been put into place. It could have been because of desire to fit in with society's expectations, a desire for economic and social freedom, or for social issues, for family issues, which contributed to the short stay with his mother. After enlisting, he took 5 months basic training, a short period of time, considering that he spent the majority of his life in a secluded and restrictive institution. He was posted in France on March 9th, 1916, where he participated in the Battle of the Somme. On the 16th of November 1916, Joseph received a gunshot wound to the head, likely during the Battle of, I don't actually know which, which commenced on the 13th of November 1916. He was transferred to a hospital and died on the 18th. Because he died without any children and being illegitimate himself, his mother was not entitled to his Victory Medal or his British War Medal, and Bob will return to the War Office. His death was announced in the Milan Gazette newspaper, which is just there. And then, in conclusion. The experiences and lives of four men display that people with learning disabilities did fully participate in the First World War. Until recently, their sacrifice and contributions have been hidden from history, something that will shortly be resolved thanks to contributions from everybody today. There are 11 other soldiers which are found, which all have their own individual stories, but in the early stages of the research and the time limitations on this presentation, obviously haven't been able to include them all. That's pretty much it.
Brilliant. Thanks. So just really, really briefly, I've got a PowerPoint presentation for this, really, really briefly, just to sum up. Debbie's work is fantastically important because it proves, it's proof positive. People with learning disabilities, mental deficiency, imbeciles, whatever you want to call them by their historical names, playing a full part in World War One, and there's more records in terms of World War Two records, are much easier to find. There's a little sort of two letters, UA, that you'll find in World War Two records, which means unarmed, which is army code for people with mental deficiency or people with learning disabilities. So much easier to find in World War Two. The point being, in both world wars, despite being excluded from society by being placed in institutions, people with learning disability fought to be part of the fight, fought to contribute, often as we've seen, as Debbie just shown us, contribute and give their lives in defence of their country. Whatever you might think about that. One of the key points, one of the key reasons for starting this, to prove and uncover this in history, has taken a massive step forward over the last month. Alongside Debbie's records, I've also met with a fantastic guy, Lieutenant Colonel John Starling, retired, who has written the history book, what's called the Labour Corps. The Labour Corps became the Pioneer Corps that Jess mentioned earlier on. The Labour Corps is the part of the army that goes and does the labour, basically. John's book on the Labour Corps, its title is No Labour, No War. In other words, what he's highlighting is the fact that without people digging trenches, building walls, building the machinery of war, if you like, then it doesn't take place. That's often where people with learning disabilities ended up, especially in World War II. This is the important bit of this next phase of the research. Both Debbie and I have found proof positive names of people who were who fought and died during World War One. So that's a fantastically exciting part, because Debbie's going to continue with her research. Thanks to John, I've identified some new archives. There was a hospital in Southampton called Netley Hospital, where people from field army hospitals were sent back to, it's called sent down the line. They were sent back to Netley if they had some sort of mental illness, mental health problems, or mental deficiency. So we're starting to explore those archives as well. And we're uncovering more and more and more names of people with learning disabilities who fought and died during World War One. So that's it, we'll shut up. Thanks very much for listening. Hope you found it interesting, and hopefully enjoy the rest of the
findings will go into that. Some of the existing findings we put in our exhibition. Everything will be available online, so please keep following us, follow us on Facebook, go to our website, and you will find out more about this very exciting, evolving project. Now,
on to our fantastic performance. We're about to start. I do have to make a very slight announcement. You probably noticed there are cameras everywhere, people taking photos. What we really like is during interval or after the show, we'd like to be able to approach you and get your impressions on the programme. It's really important for us to see and to hear what your impressions are. So if you're happy to be interviewed, then we'd love to interview you. If you don't want to be on camera, just find somebody with one of these tops on and let us know, and we'll take your details and we'll make sure that you're not included on any of the films. Anyway, I hope you enjoy the rest of the show. It's about to start. Thank you.
Stories of people with learning disabilities, their journeys and contributions to the First World War. The 1900s, Victorian Street Games. Thank you. 1913, a silence. In 1913, people with learning disabilities were called different names. Some people with learning disabilities were sent to live in lunatic asylums. World War I begins. Your country needs you. Thank you. Training.
Thank you.
1950 Royal Hospital Scheme.
There's a rose that grows in no man's land, and it's wonderful to see. All its fragrances, it will live for years in my it's the water rose that's older rose. It's the rock of the master's hand. Neath the world's greatness, how stands a red cross nurse. She's the
soldiers needed somewhere to go. Nudity asylums were renamed war hospitals. Within 5 weeks, 12,000 people who lived in the asylums were thrown out. Home front, Canary Girls, munitions factory workers.
I've never been in a factory before, but the crisis made you think. I thought, well, my brothers and my friends are in France. So a friend and I thought to ourselves, well, let's do something. We work 10 hours a day. That's from 8 in the morning till 12:45. No break. An hour for dinner. Back again until 6:30. No break. It was terribly hard. Terribly monotonous. But we had a purpose. Everybody seemed unaware of the powder around them, unaware of any danger. After each day, when we got home, we had a lovely good wash. And believe me, the water was blood red and our skin was perfectly yellow. Right down through the body, legs and toenails even, perfectly yellow. The hair, if it was fair or brown, it went a beautiful gold. But if there was any grey, it went grass green. But we were just one big happy family. It was amazing, and I shall never forget it as long as I live. The way those women worked and talked and chatted about their ordinary everyday experiences, their boys at the front. But mind you, it was the boys at the front that we worried about and thought about. And that's what made us work like that.
Salmon prawn.
Thank you.
1916, conscription. If you're able to fight in the war, you have to, by law. Drum calls.
Thank you.
trenches. All your earth that you put out, you put in front, about a yard in front of the front of the trench, you throw your earth there, and you would dig down about 4 feet, and you call the back of the trench the paradow. You call the front of the trench the parapet. On the paradow side, you would dig down for another 18 inches to 2 feet, thus leaving a shelf, which was called the fire step. In addition to fire step, one of the things that you would find in every bay was a miniature fireplace, always on the reverse side, on the parallel side of the trench, with a little fireplace where you used to have a brew up. Each bay would hold 3 men. At night time, those 3 men would be close together, one standing up, looking over the top. He was sentry. The next man would be sitting next to him, close up to his leg, so that if anything happened, if anything was suspicious out in front, the sentry could just kick the man next to him, and they would both get up together and have another look. And the third man was allowed to lie out on the fire step and sleep.
Thank you. Us five got talking. We was in the know. Ah, well, says Jimmy, and he's seen some scrapping. There ain't no more than five things as can happen. You get knocked out, else wounded, bad or cushy. Scuppered or nout, except you're feeling mushy. One of us got the knockout, blown to chops. One lad was hurt like, losing both his props. And one, to use the word of hypocrites, had the misfortune to be took by Fritz. Now me, I wasn't scratched, praise God Almighty. Though next time, please, I'll thank him for a blighty. For poor old Jim, he's living and he's not. He reckoned he'd five chances and he had. He's wounded, killed and prisoner, all the lot. The flaming lot all rolled in one. Jim's mad.
Shell shock. When some soldiers came back, they could be in a room and be safe, but still feel scared. That's post-traumatic stress disorder.
Thank you.
We shall not see the world is crying.
War is over!
Letter from November, 1918. Armistice. We remember the part that people with brain disabilities played in World War I. Their stories no longer hidden. And remember friends and family whose lives have been affected by the war. We have given ourselves new names that we are proud of.
our volunteers. Thank you to our technicians. Thank you also to Labour Park Theatre, our funders, Heritage Lottery Fund and Arts Council England. Again, without our funder support tonight would not have happened and this whole project wouldn't have. Thank you to our researchers, who you may have seen earlier on, from Ruskin College, Liverpool University, and also My Life, My Choice. And they've supported us in this whole project. Without them, we wouldn't have been able to put the exhibition on that you've seen. And for your information, that exhibition is moving on to Bromley Library from tomorrow. It's going to be there for about 5 weeks. Please come and see it. Bring all your friends. It's a fantastic opportunity, really, for the dancers to show their work and the research that they've done. Can I thank also Bromley Library for their amazing support for their talks, Jane Cameron and the rest of your team. And also, I can't miss out on our project manager, Aaron.